As we continue on our theme for 2017, which is the kingdom of God, living in light of spiritual reality, living in light of spiritual reality. And I clarified or tried to clarify what I mean by living in light of spiritual reality in our last message. And we'll continue to do that as we go along, because we want to understand it as clear as we can as we proceed through the year. We're going to be doing this all through the year. This will be a theme all through the year. We hope to set in order all of the teachings of the scriptures, in the sense of the doctrines, the foundational doctrines, the concepts that bring forth those doctrines, the events in history that create those doctrines. One of the things that is wonderful about our faith is that our faith is historical. It's public. It happened in time. It happened in a geographical location. It is birthed through the acts of God. It is an idea thought up by men. Men didn't sit down and think on the issues of life and then come out or come forth with the beliefs that make up our faith. They are born out of the acts of God in history. As he acts in history, he reveals those aspects of his character and his nature. He reveals his plans and his purposes, and out of those come the truths that make up our faith, spiritual reality. And so we're focusing on that this year, because obviously for decades we have been undergoing some dramatic changes. We speak of it constantly, and I'll give one more example this morning as we try to apply, well, we will apply the Word of God to our day. And that's the thing that we want to grasp, that as we continue in our journey and in our study of the scriptures, we're learning the truth. We're learning that which fits reality, that is consistent with the world. And of course, to help us make sense of the world, to help us understand what is happening in the world, so that we can make proper judgments and then proper decisions and place ourselves in the right place. And that right place, of course, is in harmony and in relationship and in harmony with God, keeping in step with him as he continues his forward march toward history. God, of course, is outside of time, but we are within time, so we see him acting in our days and in our weeks and in our years and in the decades and the centuries, leading to a time of consummation, of concluding all that he has begun to do and bring us to a glorious conclusion. The kingdom of God established here on the earth, a kingdom of righteousness, joy, and peace in the Holy Spirit, as it is described for us by the Apostle Paul, and not just the Apostle Paul, but prior to the Apostle, by the prophets of God, who crafted this gospel, this good news for mankind. And so let's begin this morning by following along in Acts 17, beginning at verse 16, the experience of the Apostle Paul as he goes forth in obedience to Jesus the Christ to be the proclaimer of the gospel, not just to his people Israel, but the Gentiles, the nations, the families of the earth, as God promised through Abraham. And so in verse 16 of Acts 17, begins like this. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens in one of his missionary journeys through the nations, his spirit, Paul's spirit, was provoked within him when he saw that the city was given over to idols. Therefore, he reasoned in the synagogue with the Jews and with the Gentile worshipers, and in the marketplace daily with those who happened to be there. Then certain Epicureans and Stoic philosophers encountered him, and some said, "What does this babbler want to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a proclaimer of foreign gods, because he preached to them Jesus and the resurrection." And they took him and brought him to the Areopagus, saying, "May we know what this new doctrine is of which you speak? For you are bringing some strange things to our ears. Therefore, we want to know what these things mean." For all Athenians and the foreigners who were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Then Paul stood in the midst of the Areopagus and said, Men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are very religious, for as I was passing through and considering the object of your worship, I found an altar with this inscription, To the unknown God. Therefore, the one whom you worship without knowing, him I proclaim to you. God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands, nor is he worshipped with men's hands as though he needed anything, since he gives to all life, breath, and all things. And he has made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth, and has determined their preappointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings, so that they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might grope for him and find him, though he is not far from each one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as also some of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. Therefore, since we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. Truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent, because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. And when they heard of the resurrection of the dead, some mocked, while others said, We will hear again on this matter. So Paul departed from among them. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Yeshua, thank you again, Father, for the privilege of assembling together as the body of the redeemed, the body of Christ, the body of our Messiah, Yeshua. Thank you that we are able to open the scriptures, Lord God, that we may immerse ourselves in your word, Father, to learn truth. We acknowledge that it is your Holy Spirit who is the teacher, the anointing that resides in us to instruct us out of this truth. And so we pray in the words of King David, open our eyes, Lord, that we may behold wondrous things out of your Torah and the writings of Messiah's apostles. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen. Amen. If you use your computer this Friday, if you Googled, you probably noticed the Google Doodle. The Google Doodle, that's the illustration that pops up around the Google name when you open your computer. What you may not know that I didn't know this until Friday morning when I noticed it, and my son Peter explained to me what that was because I brought it to his attention. So he explained to me that since 2018, and he didn't give me all these details, I found out this later, but since 2008, rather, Google has been holding a competition among school-age children, kindergarten to 12, called Doodle for Google, to see who can create, of course, the best doodle. That's that picture that you see around the name on the internet. The winner, of course, is handsomely rewarded. And their artwork is displayed. It's displayed for 24 hours. And it's displayed there, of course, for the millions of Google users to see. In 2016, this was the most visited site of anything. More people visited or used this search engine than anything else. So it's there for all the millions of Google users to see. And this Friday's winner, this past Friday, out of 4,200 entries, listen to that, 4,200 entries. Out of 4,200 entries, this Friday, the winner was a 15-year-old girl from Stratford, Connecticut. Her name is Sarah Harrison. She's a 10th grade student. She goes to Bunnell High School, and she won the contest, and she was awarded wonderfully, of course. Sarah, along among other things that she received, she got a $30,000 scholarship. $30,000 scholarship. It's part of the program, the Google program, that the school that the student is attending get a prize as well. So her high school got a little something as well. The school was awarded $50,000. In a grant, of course, to enable education. And It's no doubt that the school and the students and the teachers and everyone was very happy for Sarah and happy for her doodle. The theme for the competition, the theme, because it has a theme every time, the theme for the competition was, quote, what I see for the future. Now listen to that. What I see for the future. So here is this theme handed for whoever will participate, in this instance, 4,200 school-aged children. And this is the theme. Think about what you see for the future and draw something that will convey that that you see. Sarah, who titled her doodle A Happy Future, that is the name of her doodle, told Google, quote, I wanted to draw something that I hoped would show that we can all get along well and that it's possible for us to be happy with each other. I dream of a future where everyone is safe and accepted wherever they go, wherever they are. My future, Sarah said, is a world where we can all learn to love each other despite our religion, our gender, our race, ethnicity, or sexuality. The Google panel of judges, which included Olympic gold medalist Simone Biles. Who remembers Simone Biles from the Olympics? The young black girl that's just awesome on the gymnastics. That's what I watch. That's what we watch in the Olympics gymnastics. Fantastic young lady. She was one of the Google panel of judges. The panel described her doodle as, quote, splendid. A, quote, visionary piece showing the future as a harmonious community. William Floyd, he is the head of external affairs there at Google, said that Sarah's drawing was chosen. It was selected because it represented everything that they were looking for when they chose this year's topic. They were looking for something that would represent diversity, inclusion, and respect. And so what is Sarah's vision for a peaceful future? Let me just ask you this. Did anyone see it? Who didn't see it? Well, just of course, if you didn't Google, you didn't see it. If you did Google on Friday, and it was on Friday and parts of Saturday, I believe, you see this. I sometimes miss it. I ask that because I get on Google a lot. Every day I get on it to study, to research, to do whatever. And oftentimes I don't see it. I don't even pay attention to it. I know that it's there. I've seen it from the other previous times, so I just don't even glance it. Friday, of course, I did it again, but it caught my attention, and I looked at it. And the reason that it caught my attention, because it looked very much like the coexist. Do you remember the coexist invented by, I believe, what's his name, the rock and roll guy? Bono? It's pictures of the various religions, the symbols for the various religions of the world, and when you put them together, they make the word, they form the word coexist. You know, once again, pitching that vision. And hers looks similar to that, so that caught my attention, and then as I looked closer, I realized that it wasn't that, it was something else, and I became interested, of course, and wanted to know what that was, and all of this has come out. Very interesting that all of this is true. And so what is Sarah's vision for a peaceful future? What did her doodle represent? Well, her doodle was a picture of 8 children. If you can imagine this, and if not, you can go to Google and type in doodle for Google Sarah Harrison, and her picture will come up if you want to get a picture of it. You should. You ought to. It's a picture of 8 children of different skin colors, different religions are represented, Islam, Judaism, Christianity, and they're obviously very happily standing together side by side. They're all in a row, of course, embracing. And 6 of the children wore shirts with letters and symbols that spelled out Google, because that's one of the things that you want to accomplish, of course, with the illustration, you spell out Google. So they have symbols on their shirts that spell out Google, but also they highlighted the quote, and I use quote because this is something that, a term that is out there, and we need to understand it, and hopefully we'll discuss it later on, that highlighted the diversity. There's much being said about diversity, and we need to get into that as well. The diversity that is being celebrated and promoted today in the doodle, one boy wore a rainbow-colored G, and we don't need to be told what that represents, rainbow colored G, obviously it's in reference to the homosexual, that segment of our culture, the homosexuals. Another sign was on the t-shirt of another the child, represented the transgenders, because it didn't have the symbol simply for male and female, but the other one that represents transgenderism. And on the other side, on the one side and on the other, were a disabled white boy, one on a wheelchair, and another one on a cane. You know, if you get to looking at all that, you're going to get into the huge conversation that is being held even now, even still, about what it means or what she meant or what she meant to convey, and that's for another time. And there is much being said, and maybe we can talk about it tonight as we discuss this, the message that I'm sharing this morning. But for this morning, I simply want to point out that once again, using an immensely powerful medium of communication, a medium that guarantees that millions are going to see it, the liberal left in our culture has, again, set before the eyes of the world, even if it was only for 24 hours, they've set before the eyes of the world a reminder that in our day, there is a vision for the future that is being feverishly worked out. Feverishly, passionately, energetically being worked out. And the reason we know that is true, because we're being reminded constantly in our culture. For example, the movie that just came out, Beauty and the Beast, and the fuss that was made concerning the way it was changed on purpose to, again, put before us how wonderful it is to have this diversity in our culture. And including in the story, changing the story, perverting the story, I say, by introducing this gay theme into it, or this homosexual theme into it. And this is just one of many examples that we can list. But one more time, in a very powerful way, we're being reminded there's a vision that has been cast, and there are many who are at work with passion and with energy to work it out. And this is why this caught my attention. Because we were talking about, you know, by now we say, you know, nothing is beyond this group. They're not going to say there's just something just that we just won't do in the carrying out of our vision, or in the promoting of our vision, or in the casting forth of our vision. They're going to do everything they need to do to keep this ever before us. Because remember, when we talked about this several years ago, that this is part of their methodology. Just keep this before the culture over and over. Don't let them forget it, so that they can see it, they can smell it, they can taste it. They have to immerse themselves in it. And before they know it, they think it's right. They think it's normal. And they accept it. And they don't just accept it, but they will promote it with us, and they'll celebrate it with us. We know that that's what is taking place. It is a clear vision. This isn't a vague, hard to understand vision that has been cast and is being worked out. It's a clear vision. It is described in terms that appeal to everyone, even the ones who would hear it and say, wait, I'm going to put the brakes on this, because also it sounds awesome, it sounds wonderful, but no, I don't agree with this. Very few are able to do that, because they are caught up with the clarity of the vision, with the terms that are used, because they appeal to everyone, because it inspires hope. And day after day, gains support from all segments of the culture are jumping on, as is obvious in the case of Google and Sarah Harrison. If you are on board with this vision, you get rewarded, and you get applauded, and you get celebrated, and you get lifted up, even if it's for a while. I imagine that Sarah is going to carry this with her for a long, long time. This moment in the limelight, in the spotlight, this moment of fame. Because she literally went around the world. Now the world knows who she is. There's pictures of her everywhere. An insight into who she is. She is, as they say about the internet, once you're out there forever, right? We're never going to forget about Sarah. You are made to feel that you are a special part of that visionary and progressive group of world shakers and history makers that has all the right answers to the questions that perplex us and the solutions to the evil that plague us. I imagine if Sarah thought herself small or insignificant, now she sees herself as someone at the forefront of this. Of this visionary effort. She's been put there on purpose. This group does this on purpose. You are led to believe that you are special because you see what others do not see. That we can create a world where everyone can simply be themselves, whatever they believe themselves to be. You know, we can look beyond our differences, we can celebrate our differences and love one another. Who doesn't want that kind of a world? Who doesn't want to create that kind of a world? Who doesn't want to live in a community that's that kind of a community? Who wants to reject that vision? This is the worldview of half our country. It is the worldview of half of our country and certainly large parts of the world. And we need to know that it is gaining strength. It is gaining strength in numbers. It is gaining strength in influence. Sarah Harrison represents that up-and-coming generation that is being denied the opportunity to look to history, to properly make a judgment concerning the present, and then to form an accurate vision of the future. This is what Sarah sees. She took the theme, she ran with it, and this is what she came out of. This came out of her heart. This came out of her soul. This came out of who Sarah is, and she represents a generation that has been created, made to be this kind of a generation, molded and made into this kind of a generation. She has formed a vision of the future, except that she has formed it without properly appraising the present based on the past, based on history. We want to understand that. We want to at least know this much about this. Again, there's much more to the whole story and what the picture represents and all the arguments that are going back and forth. But for our purposes, this. Because it ties in with what we are desiring to understand as we proceed in the Word of God, proceed in the study of the Scriptures with this theme in mind, that we're looking for the overarching truths, the bigger truths. And to do that, of course, you have to go back. You have to go back where these truths have been revealed and established and have been confirmed to be true, and to know that it is part of a history that has a bearing on the present and that definitely guides the future. Sarah has been denied that. You know, I don't know her religious upbringing, her home life, anything like that. We don't have to, because we know our culture. We know the push that the culture is exerting. We know the pressure that our culture is exerting, that it is from all fronts, that unless you are firmly rooted and grounded in spiritual reality, you can't help but becoming part of this progressive, visionary group that is looking to a future in which we use terms like accepted, respected, happy, no matter what, no matter who you are, no matter what you believe, no matter what you think yourself to be. Because to this group, this is what matters, and this is the goal, this is the aim of all of their work, to create this kind of a world. In Acts chapter 17, what we just read, the Apostle Paul is speaking to those in the city of Athens. Athens is the center of a culture that has become famous, that was famous back then, is still famous, for exalting man, and for exalting the wisdom of man, creating a culture of global influence. As we said many times before, what the Greeks created centuries before is still with us. We still think like Greeks. We still act like Greeks. We still speak like Greeks. Our Culture reveals the Greek influence, our architecture, our entertainment, our understanding. And this, when I say our, I'm not talking about us as believers. I'm talking about the world, the unbelieving world. The influence was immense, continues to be just that. Paul is speaking in the capital of this place of learning and knowledge and philosophy and wisdom, and the place that celebrates the greatness of man and the beauty of man and the wisdom of man. And he comes here because he is going forth in obedience to the word of Jesus the Christ, that he was called from before he was formed in the womb of his mother. God knew him and ordained him that he should be this. First that he should know God, and then he should know Jesus the Christ, and then be sent forth into the world to proclaim spiritual reality wherever he went. He goes out of the borders of his own nation, Israel, and goes to the Gentile, because that is his calling, to go to the Gentiles, to the nations, and to tell them the truth. So he doesn't come to this place to do what is customary. For example, in verse 21 here of Acts 17, he comes to a place and comes to a culture that they love doing one thing. They love to talk about. They love to talk about stuff. They like to discuss. They like to bring up issues. They like to ask questions. And then they like to spend days and days and weeks and months and years, however long it takes, discussing it and talking about it. And hopefully down the line find a solution, an answer. This is philosophy. This is Greek philosophy. Philosophers that ask the questions and then try to find the answers. This is what is happening in verse 21. It says, because the Athenians and the foreigners who were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. So when you came to this place, you didn't come here to say, to bring a particular view and then stress that this particular view was right. No, this was a place of discussion. This was a place of where everybody is accepted for who they are and where they came from. Let's sit down, let's discuss, let's talk. And after a while, it just degenerates into talking, into discussing, into just delving into the various ideas, the different ideas. The Apostle Paul comes with a different goal, with a different aim. He doesn't come to do what is customary. He doesn't come to discuss different ideas and to add to the current wisdom. He comes in obedience to Jesus of Christ to do something that God is already famous for in the world. To do something that God is already famous for in the world to those who know him, to those who have received knowledge of him. He comes to demolish the house that has been built, to destroy it from the top to the very foundation, to destroy what has been built by man and therefore by idolatry. How many know that that takes a lot of courage? Now, it's different preaching in Israel, because Israel has been part of this story from the very beginning. This is something that they're familiar with. The concepts that Paul is going to talk and discuss and share, they're familiar with that. But outside the borders of Israel, where there's a different worldview, where everyone has a different understanding of the past and the present, and certainly a different understanding of the future, he goes there, and he goes there in the power of the Holy Spirit, filled with not just supernatural power, but an inward conviction that what he is going to do, of course, is right and true. He cannot do it because history attests to the truth of it, to what he's about to do. And he goes to this center of idolatry and glorification of man and glorifying of man's wisdom, and he begins to speak to them because he sees the surroundings. He sees the various objects, the various images of the various gods that they think they know and understand, and with one image they confess that they don't know, that they don't have the truth, that they don't have all the answers, because one image says to the unknown God. And they confess what they've known all along, that we by ourselves are unable to find the answers to the truth. Paul sees that. Paul acknowledges that, and he takes the opportunity then to approach them based on this confession that this culture has made. You confess that you do not have all the answers. Let me tell you. Let me give you the answers. Paul has the answers. And so he begins in verse 24. God, who made the world and everything in it. And notice what Paul does. As he doesn't join in the conversation and see what is going on, he comes in literally like a bulldozer with that intent to demolish everything they think is right, everything they think is true. And he begins simply with the words of Genesis, God, who made the world and everything in it. This is where Paul begins to understand reality. He begins where God told them to begin. And he, of course, he being a Jew, being an Israelite, he has in his history that which we've been talking about for the past several weeks, that when God brings Israel out of Egypt, he brings a people that whose mind has been overwhelmed by worldliness and idolatry, and their history has been all but erased and forgotten, and God now has to begin the work of demolishing that worldview and then beginning to write, if you will, on the tablets of their memory, on the blank pages of their memory, true history, true reality, to make them, to mold them, to fashion them into his people, to his redeemed people. And Paul is one of those, and he has that experience. And when he comes to this culture, that is a culture built on idolatry, built on ideas of men, built on visions of what man can do and what man has the ability to do, he does what God did for them. He does for this group what God did for them. He destroys the world that they've built. He annihilates their worldview and begins then to build up, to create that which is according to spiritual reality. And he begins with God. God, who made the world and everything in it, since he is Lord of heaven and earth, does not dwell in temples made with hands. That destroys their entire understanding of the world. So Paul doesn't begin to explain God. He begins with God. He doesn't try to start at a certain place and build up to the existence of God. He can't do that because God didn't teach him that way. At the Exodus event, the cause of the Exodus event was the revelation of God, was the self-revelation of God. Israel didn't have to have God tell them, in the beginning God created, in the beginning there's nothing and then there's God, or anything like that. He didn't try to tell them about how he came into existence. God didn't have to tell that to Israel because they met him in Egypt, and they experienced him in Egypt, and they witnessed him in Egypt. And so when God takes them back to the very beginning to begin to instruct them about history and spiritual reality, he simply begins with himself. And from then on, Israel knows to simply begin with God, because that's spiritual reality. That's the truth. He doesn't explain God. He doesn't lead up to God in his argument. He begins with God. He begins with the testimony of the book of Genesis, of the history that God revealed to Israel, just like God told Israel through Moses after the Exodus. And he begins to give them an understanding of the truth, of the way it is. And we need to go back into this very rapidly, because what is it that we need to understand in our day? That what has happened through history is going to happen again in our culture, in the world. It is going to happen again. And God wants us, He wants us to be at that place in which when the demolishing takes place, we don't suffer. Although some may suffer anyway. Because it is historical that the people of God, when God acts, there are people. There are the people of God, the righteous people of God, who suffer as well. Who suffer as well. But it doesn't matter, because we understand the purpose for it, and we know, of course, the end of it, the conclusion of it, the culmination of it. And it's absolutely necessary that we understand that in our day, the Lord is accomplishing this work of raising up that body of believers that understands, that has understanding, that can look at this doodle and instantly discern the deception, and instantly discern the the plans and the purposes and where it's leading and why it can't and why it shouldn't and why we should speak and why we should demonstrate the truth. Not just speak, not just talk, but provide evidence, provide proof of the things that we say. What should would inspire us to do that? We have the words of Jesus, who said that he would confirm the words of his servants. God, who said it first to the people of Israel. Jesus, who said it to his through his apostles, who said that signs would follow those who were the disciples and the believers in Jesus the Christ, that he would confirm spiritual reality for those of us who were willing, bold, and courageous enough to proclaim it, to declare it, and then to live in its truths. Something that is desperately needed in our day, as we see Sarah Harrison draw and create something out of her heart and out of her soul. And this is a revelation of who she has become and who she has been made to be. And if something doesn't happen in her life, if there isn't an intervention, she will be one of those architects of that vision that is ultimately destined to fail. Ultimately destined to fail. What a tragic thing this is, that this young lady at such a tender age is putting all of her hopes in men, in man, in our ability to love and to accept and desire the best for our brother and our sister and our neighbor. That we can look beyond differences, that we can set aside religious differences and ethnic differences and put all that aside, all for the purpose of creating a happy place. What a tragic thing it will be when that is shattered. For many, it is shattered and continues to be shattered. And unfortunately, many don't have the solution that will keep them from being shattered. The gospel that promises something just as wonderful, but something that can be accomplished because it is a vision from the heart of God. A vision that God has cast from the very beginning and has proven over and over that he can accomplish it, that he can do it. The Apostle Paul comes to this group who has been solidified into a culture that glorifies man and exalts man and pursues the greatness of man and believes that their culture that they have created is the culture that should be. And Paul comes to destroy it, to demolish it, and let them know. Give them the wake-up call that we talked about in previous studies. Push the reset button that we talked about in previous studies. Put the brakes on that we talked about in previous studies. And so he does. God is the creator of everything, and therefore he is master of heaven and earth. And he cannot be reduced to someone who can dwell in temples made with hands. In other words, God does not need man for anything. What a wake-up call that is for the Greeks, who prided themselves in the wonderful temples and in the wonderful methods of worship and all this, as other cultures. No, this isn't the true God. He is not worshipped with men's hands. You don't worship God with things you create. You don't fashion things and then present them to God for his approval. Remember when God tells them how to build an altar? What does he tell them? Build it with stones. Stones that are there. Don't put a cutting tool to them. Don't fashion the stone that you're going to make my altar out of. Because once you do, you defile it. And we're told, we are made aware that it is God who is God and Lord of all. And he is leading us all and guiding us all on how to be and how to live. Neither is he worshiped with men's hands as though he needed anything. He gives life to everything, breath to everything, to all things. And he made from one blood every nation of men to dwell on all the face of the earth. And here is that vision, perverted, twisted, of the left. We're all human. We're all the same. We're all one blood. Let's all get together. Let's all get along. It's true. God made us all from one blood. Every nation of men to dwell on the face of the earth. And he has determined their pre-appointed times and the boundaries of their dwellings. Here is that which this vision crashes into, that God has designed borders and limits. He's created nations. And there's a purpose for that. He says in verse 27, so that each one in their place should seek the Lord. Here is the purpose for all history, that everyone should seek the Lord, that they might grope for the Lord and find the Lord, meaning he can be found. Because in him we live and move and have our being. As some of your poets have said, he quotes some of the conventional wisdom. Therefore, since we are the creatures of God, those that have been made by God, we ought not to think that the divine nature is like gold or silver or stone, something shaped by art and man's devising. We have the witness in ourselves. We look at ourselves, and in honesty, we know that we are special, that we are the work, the handiwork of a divine creator. And says, verse 30, truly these times of ignorance God has overlooked. And here Paul reveals to this group of people, this culture, that history has changed, that history isn't simply going forward the way it has always been. God has done something in history that demands a change of course. Because these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now God commands all men everywhere to God commands everyone in the world, everyone in the planet, all cultures to change their mind. And he points this particular group of people to the one that represents that radical change in history, Jesus the Christ. Because he has appointed a day on which he will judge the world by righteousness by the man whom he has ordained. We know that that's Yeshua. He has given assurance of this to all by raising him from the dead. The world is heading at breakneck speed in the direction that it has always headed, away from God, disregarding God. And in order to do that, you have to deny history. You have to put a blind eye to what has happened in the past. You have to deny that something has happened in the past that determines the course, the condition of the present, and therefore the course of the future. And this is what is so tragic about our culture. What is so tragic about Sarah and her generation and her school that is so glad for $50,000 that will help them in their technology and in their courses and in their education. Who are receiving pressure from all sides to keep their mouth quiet and not say anything and not speak against this vision and not stand up and say this can't be right. This doesn't reflect what equality really is and what justice really is, because we already have a definition for those universal concepts, and it is the God of Israel that has revealed them and defined them, and they are brought forth beautifully, clearly, wonderfully, undeniably in the life of Jesus the Christ and in his death and in his resurrection. And therefore our guide to understanding the present is the God of the Exodus and Jesus the Christ. Our guide to forming an accurate picture of the future, an accurate vision of the future and what we can hope for in the future, is the God of the Exodus and Jesus the Christ. And what he has done, what he has accomplished. Why? Because what Jesus the Christ accomplished depends on what God accomplished in the Exodus. The work of Jesus in his death and his resurrection is based on the work of God in the Exodus. They're connected. They're two major historical events that have made this powerful, undeniable statement in the world. There is God. He is Lord of all. He is the Lord of history. He has determined the design of man for the purpose of knowing God and serving God, for the purposes of man, to take us all to a glorious conclusion, a kingdom of righteousness and holiness, a kingdom of glorified human beings, born again, filled with the Spirit, who know their Creator, who understand their Creator, who love their Creator, who worship their Creator, who serve the purposes of their Creator, who live according to design and purpose. Culture blindly barreling forward, spurred on by these things, this doodle for Google, that causes that passion and that fire to burn even brighter in those who are currently involved in it, and then preparing the next generation to take the baton and take it on forward. We're living truly in perilous times. And we talk about this because we're coming soon to the celebration of the Exodus, to the observance of the Exodus, to a remember of the Exodus as we remembrance of the Exodus as we celebrate Passover. And all of these things hopefully will bring us to that moment in which we're sitting there recounting the story of God coming down to Egypt and sharing the meal and becoming again keenly aware that this represents a moment in history in which God comes down and destroys the house built by man and sets in motion a plan that is the only plan that is going to succeed. It is a redemption of lost man, tainted and perverted by sin, by the denial of spiritual truth. It's a message of redemption and salvation. And now, as the Apostle Peter admonishes us and the world, there's only one name given under heaven by which we must be redeemed and saved, Jesus the Christ. There is no other name. The Lord is working in our day to raise up those members of the body of Christ who won't be fazed and deceived and moved and taken by these things that are coming forth from all sides, however they are packaged, whether it is in a threatening way or whether it is in a way that is supposed to warm your heart. What a wonderful young lady. Look at what she drew. What vision. Look at how well she has grasped where our culture is and where it is heading, and how wonderful her understanding of that plan that will take us there. She has a vision for a happy future. It is a vision of a time and a place in which all of us can be accepted, no matter who we are or no matter who we think we are, no matter where we come from, no matter what the color of our skin is, no matter what we believe spiritual truth to be, we can be accepted. It is the happy place. In the days of the Exodus, the Lord came and he absolutely annihilated the world. In the days of Jesus the Christ, he came and he absolutely annihilated the kingdom of Satan, the kingdom of darkness, the kingdom of deceit. In those times of ignorance, God says, they're over. Now everyone is accountable. Everyone is accountable. And therefore, he commands everyone to repent and believe in Jesus the Christ. The hope for the future is bound up in Jesus the Christ, who will come back and set everything straight and destroy spiritual deception and make clear to all spiritual reality. As we continue in our study of the Word of God, I hope, and as we continue to see weekly the disintegration and the degradation of our culture and the perversion of truth and its growth and its the force with which is going forward, then we should be alarmed. And we should at least take Rob Dreher's vision. Remember Rob Dreher, who wrote The Benedict Option, who says there's a flood coming, to say, yes, there's a flood coming, and really there's no sense in trying to stop it, but I need to stand so that I can stand. Stand on the truth so that I can stand on the onslaught. And it is by our standing that we speak loudly and convincingly and powerfully, and therefore allow God to confirm with signs and wonders, as the Apostle Paul says. He did not come simply with words, but with signs and wonders and powerful manifestations of the Holy Spirit of God. we don't have words only, and this is, I'll finish with this, that the body of Christ does not have words only, does not have arguments simply against the direction of our culture. We have words, definitely, but then there is the power that confirms those words. The power that was demonstrated in the Exodus, the power that was demonstrated on Calvary with the death of Jesus the Christ and the resurrection 3 days later. May we become keenly aware that that is who we are and who God wants us to be in our day. Let's stand.